Thank you for joining us here at Crossfire Television. Today, a series of messages called Do You Love Me? Part two today. Throughout this summer, we're going to be showing you 11 messages for 11 weeks, a series that we taught called Do You Love Me? Now, it might sound like maybe I know about this, because many of you know that in the year, couple years after, I began to write a book, this book, called Do You Love Me? You can order it on our website at mycrossfire.com. You can also order it by going to Amazon, and you can order the book there. I encourage you not only to get this book for yourself, but to get this book for family and friends who are struggling with their identity in Christ, their identity in understanding the love of God towards them, and how to love others. And so this book has hit bestseller in four different categories as of 2022. And I believe that this message series will touch your life. It's 11 messages. I believe we will go a little further, a little deeper, a little more concise, and yet a little deeper in the book. But I believe these messages will help you in understanding the love of God in a powerful way. The overall theme of the book is taken from John 21, but we cover many areas of Scripture. And what does it mean to truly love and be loved by our Lord and Savior? I also want to take a moment and thank all of you who support this ministry, who made this book, as well as all of the different things we do on television, all of the different outreaches, all of the different things we do in this ministry and have for years, both locally and nationally and internationally. You have made it possible by your financial gifts, by your prayer support, and by your involvement. I just want to say thank you. We could not do it without you. Of course, it's the blood of Jesus. It's the sacrifice and the grace of God that is the most vital. And yet, it is those things through you and I, as we learn to love others, that we make sacrifice in gifts of time, of finances, gifts of our prayer and intercession. And as we do that, I want to tell you, you're making a huge difference in our world today. And I thank you for allowing this ministry to be a part of your giving, a part of your sacrifice, so that we can take the gospel message, a simple message of love, a simple message of hope, and we can send it around the world by teaching, preaching, in spiritual as well as tangible ways to meet the needs of those who are hurting. Thank you for making this possible. I hope you enjoy this series. You can also go online to mycrossfire.com and get this series and play it anytime. Like any of our messages, we make them available on a regular basis. And our heart is that the ministry and the Word of God would go forth. And so I encourage you to go on mycrossfire.com, find out ways you can help and ways you can receive the gospel of Jesus. Last week I talked about, started a series, and it'll go for at least the next few weeks. Do you love me? I think the world is crying out to be loved. I think that all of us, whether it's the world, the church, our spouses, I think we are calling out, desiring to be loved. That is, they're flipping things around here. That is so important, is that we come to a place that we understand what it is to be loved. And I believe that God is asking, as he asked his disciples, and actually this whole series will culminate in a couple weeks, as we answer the question, if we can love God, and how can we love God? How can we agape love the Father? And so today I want to take a quick review. Today we're going to talk about a love that is free to fail. A love that is free to fail, and why. But before we do, I want to do a quick overview of last week's message. Last week's message was,
Do you love me? When all is stripped away. We talked about the priority of love. Came out of 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13. We're going to actually take off from there with this message today. Talks about gifts without fruit are meaningless. No matter how gifted, no matter how talented, if you are gifted and yet you don't have the fruit of the Spirit that is coming from your life, it's not the right priority. And so love is a priority, the greatest of all the gifts, the greatest thing we can do. What supersedes the law is love. Number two, the qualities of love. And so we took the definition of what love is. Love is kind, for example. Love is patient. We substituted love for Jesus because we know that God is love, right? And so then we said, Jesus is kind. And then we asked the question, are you kind? Got to answer that. Jesus, sometimes, that's an honest answer right there. Jesus is patient. Are you patient? Okay, love is patient. So we went through that last week, and it ended with what we're going to start with today. Jesus never fails, amen? Love never fails, amen? You never fail. So then I ask you today, do you really agape love if you fail and love never fails? So we're going to look at that. Then the last one last week was the preeminence of love. That came out of this. Now abides faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these, the greatest of all of these is love. Okay? Our text today is coming out of Galatians chapter 5. And when you're in Galatians chapter 5, one of the things you recognize in Galatians chapter 5 is it's dealing with the law, and the opposite of the law being faith and love. Or I shouldn't say the opposite, the fulfillment of the law being faith and love. And so that's what we will get into today. And so before I do that, I want to give you some quick definitions, but I want you to remember that last week, when everything is stripped away and all that's left is Jesus, is it enough? In your life, when everything is stripped away, when you've lost everything, when someone has taken the one you love, when your children have been taken away, when you don't know where you're going to live, when your job is gone, when it's all stripped away, I want to suggest to you today that if you will remain in love and not bitter and not angry and not hateful, if you'll remain in love, you have enough. You have enough. The definition of agape, although I am very cautious in giving it because I can give you a definition of the Greek word agape love, and what I'm afraid of is that we'll take the Greek word instead of the fact that Jesus is love, and we must look at his life to understand what real love is. And so in finding real agape, we find it in Christ. We look at Christ, and that's where we find it. But agape love, or charity it's called, it is the God kind of love. It is a divine love. It is a love that has the attributes of Christ. One that is sacrificial, one that will give its life, one that will give all. It'll give everything in the pursuit of caring and being kind and being patient, one that'll give it all. Because Jesus is the expression of what agape really is, it is defined best through the attributes of Christ. And that's what we're going to attempt to do in the next few weeks, is see what agape love really is and how we can learn to not fail at love. And yet to tease you a little bit, love must fail, must have the opportunity to fail. Phileo, we got agape. Phileo is brotherly love. If you're good to me, I'm good to you. That's phileo. That's what all of us live by. That's our code. That's what our marriages are built on. And that's why they fail. Because while phileo love is not bad, it's not supernatural. It gets and it allows you to live in the flesh. Agape love, it's impossible to live in the flesh. Now, when we think of the flesh, what do we think of? Eros love. Well, she's a good-looking woman. That's what we think of. But that's sin. We don't see that just having a phileo relationship is also not the best that God has for your life. And it's why anytime we live in the flesh, we end up with less than God's best. I'll say this one more time. I said it last week. I want to say it one more time. 150 different times that love is used in the New Testament, and it is given as agape. 13 or 15 of those times that it doesn't fit the bill of being divine love. It just doesn't. What we find in those instances is someone trying to pursue the idea of being loved like that, or a case in which it has just been translated something that is close. Remember, there's multiple kinds of Greek words for love. There's also Aramaic words for love. But Greek words for love, it also is translated in a way that in some of those cases, it should have been translated storge. Storge is the kind of love that a parent would have for a child. Whether you're born again or not, a parent has a love that's different than brotherly love, and yet it's not used in the New Testament, so sometimes it replaced, that kind of love was replaced with agape, which was common at that time. But we want to look at what it is to agape love, what Jesus did to show us love. But today, we want to talk about what happens when love fails. And why must love be free to fail to be agape love? So number one, if you've got your note page, I'd encourage you to follow along. When love, in parentheses there, agape, fails, what? Now think for a second. When agape fails, and yet, didn't it say agape never fails? But by your reaction, anyone here outside of me ever fail at agape loving somebody else? This morning, I didn't want to put too much on you. You know, if I say like last week, it might be a little overwhelming to, you know, or just today. So agape love has a component of failure, and yet it's an oxymoron. Because love doesn't fail. Agape doesn't fail, and yet all of us have failed at it. See, your agape cannot fail because God never fails. Does God fail? So listen, if I'm born again of the Spirit of God, the fruit of me having a Spirit-led life, the fruit of that is agape love, right? Now, if that's true, Can agape fail? So here's the deal. There's deep. That's where you dig so deep, water starts to come up. We're not going to go that deep. Okay? There's surface. That means you didn't even break ground. We're going to dig down a foot or so. Okay? So it's not deep, but we're going to dig down a little bit. You're going to have to really pay attention, and you're going to come out of here having learned something that's going to be profitable to you. Okay? Your agape cannot fail because God never fails. It must morph into a different kind of love, like Philia or Eros. Watch this. If our love cannot fail, then it's not agape love. I'm not talking in circles. Hear what I said. If our love cannot fail, then it's not agape love. I'll prove that in scripture in just a minute. Number two. Well, not number two. That one's confused your notes here. If our love does fail, it's not agape love. If it cannot fail, it's not agape love. If our love does fail, it's not agape love. Remember what it said in 1 Corinthians 13? Love never fails. That is, agape never fails. Jesus never fails. The God in us never fails. Our love towards others never fails. So, I want to go back to this. If our love cannot fail, it isn't agape love. You may agree with this, you may disagree with this, but I want you to see something. Jesus was tempted. Do you remember the temptation of Christ? Not the movie, that was horrible, but the actual in the Bible temptation of Christ. So Jesus goes out, he's tempted. Could Jesus have failed? In this room, there's some who would say, oh yes, of course. Others would say, no, I don't think so. It's a huge philosophical debate whether Jesus could have failed or not. I would tell you this, if Jesus could not have failed, then this whole thing is a game. When he looked into the cup in the garden and he said, not my will, I believe he was looking at not what my flesh wants, but your will, what my spirit, what God's spirit, what I want in the spirit, what you have declared, what you want be done. Could Jesus have called 10,000 angels and got him off the cross? Could he? Yes. But he would not have the agape love when he did it. He had every right to. Don't get me wrong. But by nature, he couldn't. He wouldn't. Could he have? Yes. But his nature stopped him because he is agape love. What does your nature do? When given a difficult situation, when making a sacrifice for someone else, what does your nature do? I tell you, my nature does not always look a lot like Jesus. I get offended, I get hurt, I get upset. I'd like to look a little more like Jesus. See, our love cannot fail. If our love cannot fail, then it's not agape. Let me give you this. What's one of the worst things in the entire world going on right now and has ever went on in history? I would have to suggest it was probably slavery. In fact, I don't know that war is as bad as slavery, and I'll tell you why. Wars are often fought because of slavery. Freedom, people wanting freedom. Okay? Slavery. Right now, sex slavery is a big issue. We actually just dealt yesterday, my wife had to deal with a lady that is here locally that literally almost got abducted into sex slavery. Here. Now, we know those are horrible things, correct? Is sex slavery a concept of love? No. Far from it, right? Why? Why? Because somebody in the situation doesn't have a choice. A free will choice. That becomes a problem. See, God loved us and he put two trees in the garden. And one of those trees was a decision that you and I could make. And we're born in sin, but Jesus came that we would have a decision that we could make. He chooses to love us while we're yet sinners. He made a sacrifice. He died for us. He loves us unconditional. Do you know why get some of you mad, but do you know why two people should never be in a place where they're unequally yoked, where they're in a covenant unequally yoked with an unbeliever? Because you can't love like that. You can't have two people unconditional and it work out well. When you introduce leaven, when you introduce the flesh, you introduce death. Your purpose of love has to be right. So there has to be a free will aspect to our love. If our love does fail, it's not agape love. You say, well, listen, I think this is above my pay grade. This love thing is just, it's not for me. I got to tell you, it's a little funny. When you read 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and you're reading it, love is kind. Well, I'm kind. Yeah, sometimes, most of the time. I try. I'm doing a good job. And you get down to all of it. And then you read, love never fails. It's like, well, forget that. That's not me. I'm just going to have to give that one up. I think a lot of times in Scripture, don't you do that? Where you read something and you're like, huh, that ain't going to happen. You know? And that's kind of what this love never fails thing does to me. It just goes, and so I had to look at it and say, wait a second, what does it mean? If our love fails, it's not agape, what's wrong with agape love? It's not agape love that has the problem. See, agape is a fruit or an outgrowth or a produce of the Holy Spirit within us, the Spirit of God. How can the Spirit of God fail? He cannot. Love fails when it ceases being agape. See, love fails, agape fails when it ceases being agape and it morphs into something else, like Philio or Eros. Sometimes two people born again, they begin to operate in true love, agape love, not brotherly love, agape love. But over time and situations and failures and disappointments, we begin to operate outside of agape love and we begin to put laws and requirements on our love. And it becomes brotherly love, not what was birthed of God. So an example of this, a biblical example of this, before we get into Galatians chapter 5, is this. Abraham and Sarah. See, God gave a promise to Abraham. He'd be the father of many nations. You all remember that, right? Now, what did Abraham do when he looked at it and said, well, this ain't going to happen because this is supernatural. This is beyond me. I can't do this. At first, he accepted it like, wow, it's going to be something great. But then it was like, wait a second, we're going to have to work this out. I got to get my hands on this. God tells you to do something, you know you're supposed to do it, and you know why we don't do it? Because we look at it and go, well, that's good. That's just too much. That's above my pay grade once again. It's supposed to be, it's faith. Galatians chapter 5 is about faith and love. Faith and love. It is about what? Me going, oh, this is going to have to take God. There's a whole lot of people that we love Philia when we need to love them, agape, unconditional, step out first, love them no matter what, show them love like God does. See, what happened to Abraham was, Abraham took matters in his own hand and said, yeah, I'll just get over here and do it myself. And what he did is he walked from hearing the voice of God, doing what is led by the Spirit of God, into what was flesh. Still holding on to a promise of God, still sounded good, still looked good, but it wasn't good. And you know what it did? It has tormented you and I through Ishmael forever. Still now, we are tormented by that. So, he repented, God blessed Sarah, and it was counted to him as faith, okay? So now, here we are, and we're looking at when love fails. Is there a way back? Of course there is. I love that God always makes a way back. So number one, when love fails, and remember, love has to have the ability, the capacity to fail so that it's real. Otherwise, it's slavery. So it has to have that capacity. So number two, love, agape love, must be free and able to fail. Yet, like Christ, it has to be without failure. So agape must be free and able to fail, yet without failure. I shared this last week, but we put contingencies on our love. Well, I'll love you as long as you don't, da, 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 da. I'll be in relation. We all have these. We put stringence on. God doesn't do that with us. God just says, I love you. You can fail if you want. It's not going to change his love. Remember, who's hiding from who? God's not hiding from us. Adam and Eve were hiding from God. He came looking for them. He fashioned clothes for them. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. You've been called to freedom. Do not use that freedom or liberty as an opportunity for the flesh. Here's exactly what he's saying. Remember this chapter, we forget that he's talking a lot about love because we get into the whole spirit and flesh thing. We forget the fact that he starts out chapter 13 with love and faith. And so here's what happens is he comes in, he says, you have been given the freedom to operate in love, agape, or in the spirit, or you can operate in the flesh. You can operate in phileo. You can operate in eros. You can operate in hatred. All of these kinds of love, which most of our relationships are based on, for example, people leave the church because if I'm not good to them, they need this and I don't give it to them, and they're mad and they go find some pastor who will. They just need a pastor with unending amounts of money to give away. Because if your relationship is based on what you're given, it's phileo. How many of our relationships are based on somebody that's good to us? What happens when you're no longer good to them or they're no longer good to you? It's done. Why? Because phileo, flesh, always brings death, spirit always brings life. So we have to learn. It's not like we get a choice. We've got to operate in a love that refuses to fail, but has every opportunity and is given an opportunity to fail over and over and over. Jesus has an opportunity to fail over and over and doesn't. And it says right here in Hebrews chapter 4, you can turn there if you got time because I'm going to do it quick, 4:14 through 16, it says, "Seeing then that we have a high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was at all points tempted as we are, and yet without sin." Now, listen, here's the key to this. Then he says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need. Let's apply this to this, to the greatest thing of all, which is love. Let's apply this. For just a minute, can we apply this? When I can't find the supernatural strength that I need to love somebody, to be the loving person, to receive love from God and give love to someone else unconditionally, regardless of what I get back from them, when I can't do that, what does he say to do? Remember, he loved you. Remember the high priest that was tempted at all points, that was crucified for you and for me, that our sin crucified him. Remember the times you rejected him, his perfect love. Remember that. And let it drive you. Let it cause you to run to his throne, his place, where he made sacrifice for you so that you can make sacrifice for others, so that you can love others. Get the mercy, the enabling power of God. Get the mercy and the grace, the enabling power of God, and the mercy that is when you don't receive what you deserve, and God allows you to have mercy to pour out. And instead of giving somebody what they deserve, you love them like he loved you. Dude, this is good preaching. And I'm not just saying it because I'm telling you, I got this way. I'm just like, Jesus, thank you. Some days you get something from Jesus, you're just like, thank you, Lord. Listen, come and get what you need. I mean, come and get what you need. He's saying, listen, it's here for the taking. You've got all the mercy and all the grace you need to be a person who has love that doesn't fail. We got to quit saying, oh, well, yeah, that's not me. I'm not going to be that way. Oh, love never fails. Yeah, not me, you know. And we got to start being the one who runs to get it. We got to be the one that says, if God has done all that, I can live and I can love like he loves. Number three, let your freedom be turned into action. Remember, love is some things. Love is. So Galatians chapter 3 goes on and he says, I'll read the whole thing. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only don't use your liberty as an opportunity for the flesh. Oh, we do that a lot. But through love, serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest ye be consumed by one another. Warning, flesh attack. You're in the flesh. You're devouring one another. What'd you do? You moved into the flesh. And so now you're tearing one another up. What did Jesus say? Run to the place of grace. Run to the place of mercy. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. If you'll walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Your freedom must be turned into action because agape, a noun, agapeo, a verb, those kinds of things must identify who Jesus is. Thus, how do they know whether or not we belong to Jesus? By our agape, one for another. So, now, it says you should love your neighbor as yourself. I got to tell this quick story. Time is killing me right now, but I want to finish these next 2 points. My dad told this story. It's such a true story. It reminded me of something that happened to my wife yesterday. My dad, if anyone who knew my dad and heard him preach, heard him tell this story, because I think he told it every week. But he didn't, but it just felt that way a little bit. He would get up, and he would, anytime he would talk about love and about loving your neighbor as yourself, right? So he would tell this story. He had this, my mom had this gold ornate little bench with a pillow top, and the legs are like curved metal, wrought iron, you know? And, you know, when he'd get up in the middle of the night, he'd go to the bathroom, you know, or early in the morning, he'd first thing, go to the bathroom. The older you get, the quicker you got to get there, you know, I'm just saying. Which is a little evil because you get slower as you get older. You know, it's a little harder getting out of bed as you get older. But your need to get there is quick, you know. You're like, so he starts and he rounds the end of the bed, not once, often. And he swears she would shove it into his aisle, you know, way in a dark room just to hurt him. But he, you know, she didn't. And he tells a story about how he rounds the edge and he catches his little toe on that wrought iron, just really going for the bathroom, right? And it just like almost rips his toe off. Now he said, you know what I did? I looked down at my toe and I said, "Toe, why are you doing that?" He didn't do that, did he? He jumped down on the floor. He started caressing and talking to his toe. He started saying, "It's okay, toe. You're going to be okay. I think, I think you're going to make it. You're not completely broke. I think you're going to be okay." And it's swollen. It's bleeding. And he's talking to his toe. "It's going to be okay, toe." He said, "If I could, I would have stuck it in my mouth, but I wasn't able to get my foot in my mouth. And I would have just held it in my mouth." It reminded me a little of my wife who cleans out the, she goes out and cleans out the freezer. You know how you're supposed to do that, right? There's a way. You're supposed to let it thaw. Oh, but she ain't got no time for that. So what does she do? She gets a knife, you know. She's in there just, you know. And after a while, your hands get numb. And you don't realize what's happening. But you are wearing all of the skin down to the blood and the, you know, and you're destroying your hands. Well, she didn't know it until it thawed out a little bit. And this morning, she's trying to get ready, and her hands hurt, and all she could talk about was her poor little hands. She's like, "I can't do my hair. I can't put on my makeup. I can't hardly get dressed. My hands hurt so bad." Can I just ask you something? If when you hurt people, that's how you acted, you'd be fulfilling love and true repentance from fleshly love to agape, spirit-led love. If when you realized that you hurt someone, you went down and you grabbed them and you said, "I'm so sorry." See, that's where you love others like you'd love your own body. If when you hurt somebody else, it ends up hurting you because they're a part of you. You're in covenant with them. Here's the beauty. I'm about to give you I almost said something bad. I'm about to give you a modern preacher part here. Number four, you ready? This one everyone will like. I get to do everything I wish. I get to do everything I wish. And it's right here in Scripture. Let's read 17. For the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another. They oppose each other. So that you do not do the things you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law anymore. You know what that means? That when you're led by the Spirit, you get to do anything you wish. That's awesome. The question is, what's your wisher? What's your wisher? What are you wishing? See, when I'm led by the Spirit, I got to be wishing what God wants. I got to be loving like God loves. I got to be doing like God does. See, when you get to a place, then there's no law anymore. Then it's not about this list of rights and wrongs. See, he says, you live by the Spirit, the law doesn't apply anymore. Not because, listen, before you turn the TV off, stop, before you run out, Pat, stay here. Listen. Here's what he says. He says, but if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law, but it's not about your emotions. Understand something. Spirit is not your emotions. Spirit is not about how you feel. It's not about how it makes you feel. Spirit is about what God says, what God declares, who God is, the nature of God. The flesh brings death, the Spirit brings life. And so, you're not under the law because when you operate in the Spirit, it's not about if it makes you feel good or not. So let's look at the next thing. The very next thing in the Scripture is he says, let's give him a test. You want a test of whether you're in the Spirit or in the flesh? Well, here it is. It's the leading test. Who's leading you? Which dog you feeding? You got the Spirit dog or you got the flesh dog? Which one are you feeding? It's the one that's going to grow strong in your life. Okay? Who's leading you now, today, every day? Now, the works of the flesh are evident, he said. They are adultery, fornication. But Pastor, wait. I'm not under the law. I'm under the Spirit. And we moved in together because God understands and he loves me. And it feels right. I just giving you a minute. You know, just FYI, when you're living together and oh, that thing, what do they call that? Sin. And you tell me, and I just look at you and I don't say anything right away. I'm just waiting till I can say something in love that'll cause you to grow and change. Because here's the thing, guys. Here's what you got to realize. It's not about, you can't do whatever you wish, and I'm not under the law. You put yourself under the law if you're led by the flesh. When you're led by the Spirit, you get free. Agape is freedom. I'm not going to get on all these, don't worry. Uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentious, jealousy, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissension, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, revelries, and the like. I love this because, you know, he had to put "and the like" on there because he knows us. We'd be like, well, I can kill nobody. All the way anyway. He's still breathing. You know? I don't think I was technically drunk. He just covered it, and the like. Anything kind of like that. Of which I told you beforehand, just as I'm telling you, I told you in past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. He's saying there's the test. Are you living in the flesh? And then he says, oh, but if you're living in the Spirit, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. But listen, I want to, before we go, can we just take one quick look? I want to show you something. Correct sentence diagramming for the grammar teachers in the room says this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. But after reading 1 Corinthians chapter 13, I want you to just look at how this lays out. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. And then it's almost as if you can put a semicolon there, or the rest could be in parentheses. Because when you go back and you look at what love is, and remember, what's preeminent? Love. This love is agape love. It's not eros. It's not brotherly love. It's agape love. It's the kind of love that you have to have Jesus in you to have. Otherwise, you can't have it. You can love a lot of ways, and it can be good love. It's just at the end, we all die. At the end, it becomes corrupt. A lot of people live 70 years happy in marriage, and it's all good, and they did it in brotherly love. And you can do that. But God is asking you to live in His Spirit. Do you know why divorce rate is so high in the church? It's because we've left our first love. Because we haven't understand what agape love really is. Okay? But listen, you can literally go, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. What is love? It brings joy. Everything hinges on love. Peace, long-suffering. The definition is kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. That's why He said, listen, you can literally hinge everything on love your neighbor as yourself. You do that, but you can't do that outside of Jesus. You can't do it outside. Last one is this, and I'm going to close. 5, there is total freedom in agape love. Total freedom. When the Spirit, who is love, is leading, there's no need for law. There just isn't a need for it. There's no need for rules, except to show you that you're in the Spirit. That's why the Word's so powerful. It's not that it somehow is a hammer. Is it guides you? Because the Spirit needs to be leading so that there can be life and love can be genuine. So He says in 23, against such, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, against such there is no law. And those who are in Christ have been crucified. They crucify the flesh. They put it to death with its passions and its desires. If we live in the Spirit, or if the Spirit lives in us, let us also walk in the Spirit. Can I be born again and not show agape love? The answer is sure. You can be in the Spirit and walk in the flesh. But there's going to be a constant war and battle, and you'll never be fulfilled in your life. You will live unhappy, unsettled, and unfulfilled. You over here, and you're this religious, I'm just angry at everybody, and nobody's doing it, and nobody loves Jesus except me, and everybody's wrong. I'm going to tell you something. You're never going to be happy. You can share truth, but it's got to be in love. You've got to operate in love. At the same time, you can be over here and you can say, I'm in agape love, and be as much in the flesh, because you're not trying to do what God says. You're not trying to live the principles of God. But it isn't out of control. It is out of freedom. He says, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. You know what's funny about envying each other? Most of us are critical about what people have, because we wish we had it. Isn't that funny? We criticize other people because really we wish we could do that. And you know what we do? We lock ourselves up where we can't receive from God the things that we wanted anyway. Here's what He's saying. What if we started loving people? Not just the unlovely, that are poor or hurt? Or what if we love people that are snobs and rich? See, I think it's easy to love somebody who's hurting. I go to Africa, you know, I go to other parts of the world, third world countries. I see people who are hurting. It's easy to love them. It's the ones that have and take for granted and abuse and use people. Loving them is hard. That's really hard. But here's what God's saying is, anytime you fall short of the ability to love, remember what he did for you. Run to the throne of grace and get all the mercy and get all of the grace you need so you can begin to love others. And in a couple weeks, we'll talk about how that's really how you love God. Get all you need from the throne of grace that you could love others. For everyone here today, it's pretty simple. It's pretty simple that every one of us have the ability to love. It's all open for us. If we know Jesus, we can love. If we don't know Jesus, we can love, but we can't agape love because agape love is his love through us. You can love your children. You can love others. You can be a great person. See, I don't get to take credit for agape love. I just get to let it happen. I just get to let it flow. I get to let God love you through me. And when I do that, you'll see a genuineness about who I am, who really God is in me. Do you see what I'm saying? It shouldn't puff me up. Shouldn't make me think of me. When you begin to love somebody in agape love, doesn't make you anything great, but it shows forth the greatness of God. What you're going to have to do is humble yourself and bend down. Galatians chapter 6, where we just ended, it goes on. It says, if you find a brother in a fault, you who are spiritual, you who are living by the Spirit, restore such a one in a spirit of meekness, lest ye also, because if not, you also will be tempted, just like the person you've been judging. See, it's all about love. It's all about restoration. So here today, I want to ask two questions and we're going to close. I know I've done everything I could do to get this message out as fast as I could. I want to ask two quick things. If you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I'm going to give you an opportunity to come and pray with somebody and receive him as your Lord and Savior. If you've been backslidden, you've been away from God, you've been doing your own thing, your own way, and today you're like, man, I need to be led by the Spirit. I need someone to just stand with me. The Bible says if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, you'd be born again of his Spirit. And you have everything you need to love like we've been talking. The second one is if you've been a Christian and you live more in the flesh, I don't mean that you're drunk, but you're not loving like Jesus loved. You're not kind to people who give you nothing. You don't go out of your way for people who cannot help you. You're angry, you're bitter, you have envy and strife. If those things seem to be in your heart, it's not that you're evil in a sense, but you're still living out death. Death still reigns in your mortal body. God loves you. He loves you as much as he did before you even knew him. But he's given you what you need to come before his throne and receive it.
I hope that you enjoyed this part of the 11 different messages that have been made available. And I pray that today's message has touched your life and your heart. We wrote a book about the message that you're listening to today. It's called Do You Love Me? And this book is a book that I believe can help change and mold your life. What you can learn in 45 minutes of teaching is nice and hopefully useful. But what you can learn in this book And the series of messages, all 11 of them, is life-changing. To learn what it is to truly love like Christ's love, to receive his love and give his love. The series you watched today was filmed in 2019, but the book was written in 2022 as a labor of love to share the gospel of Jesus Christ around the world and for them to understand his free gift of love, one that we should share freely and one that we should, as believers, we should know it is behind everything we do, everything we say has to be love. Not what we can get, but what we can give. I want to encourage you to not only pick up the book, but also to support this ministry in prayer. We need your prayer. Support this ministry financially if you can, and you can do that by going to mycrossfire.com. If you happen to live in the Eugene Springfield area, which a portion of you would, I would encourage you, and I would say if you're not in a Bible-believing church, come grow with us. As we delve into God's Word, as we do men's and women's and youth and children's Bible studies and outreaches, and come and grow with us in the things of God. Come and show the love of God. You can't do that at home by yourself watching TV, but you can do that with your family, and you can do that beyond as we come together as the body of Christ to do the exploits of God, to do the crazy, amazing things, to be the Good Samaritan, to walk where Jesus walked here on this planet and love like Jesus loved. I hope that you'll get this book. I hope you enjoy this book. I hope that you buy this book for not only you, but family and friends. To learn what it is to have true, unconditional love is set right before you. And I hope that it touches your life. Remember, this series, there's 11 messages and then a book. I encourage you to listen to all the messages and read the book. The messages are free at www.mycrossfire.com, and you can receive them there, you can watch them there, or here on your local network. And we want you to understand the love of God. There's nothing on the planet greater. Thanks for joining with us. Thanks for supporting us. And we'll see you next week on Crossfire Television, a program that can change your life for eternity because of the power of Almighty God. Thank you.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today and make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477, 541-686-3473, or find us on the web at mycrossfire.com.